Our second reading comes from the book of Jeremiah in the 32nd chapter, a really interesting, fascinating story about doing something unusual. So listen again for God's word to you. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord in the 10th year of King Zedekiah of Judah, which was the 18th year of Nebuchadnezzar. At that time, the army of the king of Babylon was besieging Jerusalem, and the prophet Jeremiah was confined in the court of the guard that was in the palace of the king of Judah, where King Zedekiah of Judah had confined him. Jeremiah said, "The word of the Lord came to me. Hanan, son of your uncle Shalom, is going to come to you and say, 'Buy my field that is at Anatoth, for the right of redemption by purchase is yours.' Then my cousin Hanan came to me in the court of the guard, in accordance with the word of the Lord, and said to me, 'Buy my field that is at Anatoth in the land of Benjamin, for the right of possession and redemption is yours. Buy it for yourself.' Then I knew that this was the word of the Lord. And I bought the field at Anatoth from my cousin Hananel, and laid out the money to him, 17 shekels of silver. I signed the deed, sealed it, got witnesses, and weighed the money on the scales. Then I took the sealed deed of purchase containing the terms and conditions, and the open copy. I gave the deed of purchase to Baruch, son of Neriah, son of Messiah, in the presence of my cousin Hananel, in the presence of the witnesses who signed the deed of purchase, and in the presence of all the Judeans who were sitting in the court of the guard. In their presence, I charged Baruch, saying, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, take these deeds, both this sealed deed of purchase and this open deed, and put them in an earthenware jar, in order that they may last for a long time. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, houses and fields and vineyards shall again be bought in this land.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and in the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This week saw gatherings all over the world for a call to action beyond climate care in advance of the United Nations Climate Summit. These brought out upwards of 4 million people of all ages in 2,500 events in over 163 countries on all 7 continents. One of those was held here in Rochester on Friday with support from a host of organizations and student groups. One of those organizations is the Rochester Area Interfaith Climate Action, which the Greater Rochester Community of Churches is involved with. They are a group of individuals and organizations of faith-seeking. And their purpose is to create a meaningful response to climate change. In doing so, they say, we acknowledge our common conviction to care for the earth and its people. Now, I hear 3 emphases in that description, which I also see being lived out by people concerned for care for the creation. The first is that the focus is global. The Earth's environment doesn't abide by any boundaries. We are as affected by the rainforest deforestation as by those who live in them. And rising sea levels are already affecting coastal regions all over the globe. The second emphasis is that the focus is local. The Interfaith Climate Coalition's website lists 3 action areas. a community solar campaign, energy efficiency, and composting, and food waste. This work happens right here on the land we inhabit, by people we know and live beside. My retired clergy friends, Dick Myers and Dave Inglis, feel the urgency to care for creation every bit as much as Greta Thunberg and the multitude of local students who marched downtown and in New York. The third emphasis in that description that I see, I also see in the lives of Dick and Dave and so many others. The focus on creation care comes because of a deep faith conviction. It is an interfaith coalition, after all. Christian theology affirms that the earth is God's creation, and everything God made reflects the glory of God. We have looked at that and have heard you talk about that many times. Every part of creation praises God in its own unique way, and when it is devastated, when species die out, when animals suffer, when tree cover is decimated, and when waters are polluted, God is affected. God's self is affected, and the praise offered to God is affected. Creation care is profoundly theological, and it's part of our human vocation, as given us by God in Genesis. We humans are called to care for the earth, to be stewards of the gifts of creation. In our time, it means that responding to climate change is a profoundly faith-based act that finds deepest expression in how we live in this place, on this land. And that brings us to Jeremiah. Usually, the focus of that passage is said to be about hope. The hope of peace, the hope of return from exile, the hope of continued existence. And so it is. I want to suggest today that it is also about place and our connection to place. Buying a field in wartime is the opposite of the way war and the mindsets that lead to it lead us to think about that field. It's the opposite of how we've been trained to view that field. We would tend to look at it as utilitarian, and being for ourselves. We would look at it as of no consequence, or at least of little consequence relative to the consequences of war or the politics that have led to it. That God tells Jeremiah to buy the field says that God has purposes for it, that it has meaning beyond what human nations and leaders ascribe to it. There is life in that field that those around Jeremiah are overlooking. It is the opposite to buy that field. The opposite of what happens in wartime as well. Think of many fields that figure in our prominent wars, Flanders, Gettysburg. Fields that have seen so much destruction, so much killing, so much bloodshed on them. For Jeremiah to be told to buy a field in the middle of wartime when he is imprisoned says that God has a purpose and a life beyond what is currently happening, beyond what might be envisioned for that field. Today's call for climate change says the same thing. Earlier, late in the summer, about a month ago, I spent some time with Andrew and Lily at Plymouth Plantation outside Boston. Many of you have been there, I'm sure. The site of the landing of the Pilgrims, well, not really the landing, but their settlement, there, the Mayflower set up in 1620. And one of the things that's changed since I had been there before is that they now have a Native American home site. The Wampanoags were the native tribe there. And in the same area, in the same path that you walk to get to the English colony, you come first to this native home site. And it's absolutely fascinating. They have people there who are Wampanoag in descendancy. And actually, the two who were there are really involved in their native community. One was showing how a canoe would have been created out of a huge, huge log, a huge piece of tree stump. And it just involved keeping a very slow fire going. It would be tended to, gently carved out when the ashes were soft. So we carve it out, just keep it going. Didn't require any axes, didn't require any labor. It didn't require much effort at all. It was the gentle working of a natural process to carve this out. And in so doing, it also sealed so that the canoe would be waterproof. Another person was cooking and showing just how that would happen, actually cooking things that were being eaten that day. They had a site where the children might have played, they had some games, they had a winter hut, they had a summer hut. You could really see how those two people's descendants lived in communion with the land, making the land work for them and working with the land. When we left that area, we followed the path and came to the English colony, and the first thing that greeted our eyes was the tall picket fence, the very tall picket fence surrounding this English colony. And the first building and sign that you come to is the meeting house. The second floor of the meeting house has the cannons and the little windows for the cannons to be able to shoot their fodder out. And the difference, to stand in between, the difference, it was just striking. The difference between living on and with the land and working with it and making it work for you, and the walling off and the fear and the dominance that is so evident in the English colony were very, very striking. And what occurred to me in relation to Jeremiah and in relation to this week is that the English colony mindset was and is that resources were inexhaustible and they were for the taking. And if I've got them, you can't have them. The native mindset was and is that the land continues to give when it is cared for, when it is lived on in respectful partnership, and that the resources are for sharing. The difference is quite evident at Plymouth. It's quite evident in the mindsets also around the action and inaction of creation care today. In 1620, there was a choice. In 2020, there is a choice. For the sake of God, and for the sake of the praise of God, for all of God's creatures, let us make the right choice and do something as unpredictable as buying a field.